And hi, everyone. Welcome to eLearnChat, where you always learn something new, we hope. Joining us today, our co-host with so much news in her life. It's amazing. Leslie Price, coming to us from just outside London. And she's with www.learnappeal.com. If you haven't checked it out, please do so. It's a great project, a great charity, and they're doing wonderful work. And Leslie, you've got so much going on in your life. Your son just got married this weekend.
Yeah, my son got married. It was a proper Scottish wedding where all the wedding party were in kilts, including the two little page boys who were 2 and 3 years old.
That's cool.
Both wearing the kilt.
That's good. Kilts ran amok, didn't they?
Oh yes. Yep. Oh yes.
And a baby on and you're going to be a granny.
I'm going to be a granny on around about the first of November.
Cool. Well, congratulations
from all of us. 4 weeks time.
And we have.
I might have to miss a couple of shows.
Oh no, we understand. Yeah, we understand. Yeah. Bring the baby with you. You know.
No thanks.
Thanks.
Cats that bring mice are enough. Thank you very much.
That's true. Anyway, we've got a great show today. We've got Harold Mugliotti running the video switcher and mixer, and we've got two of the three amigos. You'll find them who they are out in a moment. Here we go. This show is sponsored by Relate Corporation at www.relate.com, your training and video partner. And we are back, and I call them two of the three amigos. Dr. Karl Kapp couldn't make it today, but we've got the two great amigos here. We've got Kevin Thorn. He's been on before. We all know him. A great guy, and we've got Deb Thomas on.
Hi.
Deb, you're really the brains of this whole party. I know that. You're on it. Well, you guys just did something really exciting, new, and different. Who wants to start? How did it turn out? I heard it was good.
We're still spinning.
Spinning. Did you have a great time?
Yes. Undoubtedly, Deb said it once, not too long ago. It's such an immersive kind of different way of learning that we're still trying to. It's really difficult to explain. And I've been coming up with some ideas on the best way. So I've got a line here. I'm going to share with you and see if this makes sense. Step away is a loosely structured immersive learning experience where play is paramount in the learning process and game design is the vehicle in which we use to solve learning problems. Mm-hmm. If that's not an elevator pitch, I don't know what is.
That sounds good. It makes sense. And I imagine you guys got a lot of feedback and just yourselves, what you've observed, how you've did things. Is it what you expected? And by the way, just to step back, we're talking about the Step Away conference that just happened. Was it about 2 weeks ago?
Last week.
Last week. Yeah. So that's, it's fresh right now. It's ingrained right in your brain. And it was a very clever, different concept of going to a special place which had rooms that were game-oriented. And like Kevin said, a completely immersive experience that was loosely managed, but that's part of what it's like to be in an immersive experience, and at least to make it worthwhile. And so, yeah, you guys have a lot of data coming back at you, don't you?
Yeah, we're still filtering through all that. That's true. Yeah.
Yeah. That's exciting. Was it what you thought it would be?
I think so. You know what we wanted, it was definitely what we wanted, and you know, maybe it was even more, maybe we even got more out of it than we thought, but we wanted them to, you know, play with the Lego and walk through some strategy sessions. Kevin's Lego play sessions are incredible. And it was a great way to start different parts of the days. Like sometimes it was in the morning, sometimes it was right after lunch. And it was a great way to just kind of like look at what we had just learned or what we were about to learn and try to formulate that into a Lego, well, for me, a Lego mess. I'm technically challenged with Lego, apparently. But it was really good
most
to
improved.
Like, touch those Legos and try to let go. No S. Let go of the S, Deb. Lego. And make something of it that kind of expresses what you're thinking. And it was a great way to start that design session. And then, you know, then we moved into game design and they, you know, walked away with a finished product that they're putting the final bows on it right now. And then they're going to send them to Kevin tomorrow and we're publishing them. So they'll, in a few weeks, they'll get these things in the mail and nice. They'll have their published game. So that was one of the things we hoped to get out of this. We were trying to figure out if our timing was right on that, and it worked.
Yeah, it was just going off on the Lego, what Deb was just saying, we started, it was an agenda. There was an agenda. Carl, Deborah, and I had an agenda, but we didn't have anything in front of everybody who attended, meaning they didn't know what was coming one minute from the next. Our goal was to be completely analog, meaning no laptops, no computers, mm-hmm. nothing. And Monday morning, we started out on the patio. We were just having breakfast and drinking coffee and just kind of having a chat. And in our mind, we thought we would move inside to more of a sort of seated classroom kind of way to kick things off. Carl was going to kick things off with the fundamentals of game design. And something amazing happened. That conversation just evolved on its own right there, sitting out on the patio. And it's like, okay, well, why don't we just get started? So we just grabbed the whiteboard, moved it out to the patio, and it started. It just happened. Next thing you know, we're playing a game, and then we're deconstructing that game. And then we broke out the Lego, and the question for everybody, build a model with the Lego on what problem you're trying to solve. Hmm. And when that question was posed, you saw everybody go into this deep thinking sort of metaphor, this sort of state of mind. And the rest of the morning was just everybody just helping others. Really interesting, deep, serious problems that folks are trying to solve. And then what happened by the end of the week, by Thursday, they designed from scratch, prototype, play tested, and ready for production, 5 serious games, card games. And we couldn't have asked for anything. I mean, we had people that had an idea what they were doing when they got there. We had some that had no clue on, they don't even know anything about game design, let alone how to approach it. And by the end of the week, we were able to help 5 different people create 5 serious games, card games, ready for production. I call that a win. I call that a huge success.
When we look at when we were children, you know, we spent our life playing games, or most children spent their life playing games. And we learned through playing games. And you know what? We managed to do it without tablets or computers or mobile phones.
Right. Yep.
We did it with things like Lego and Meccano and, you know, even just building blocks, or you'd go to the beach, you'd sand castles and all kinds of things.
Yeah, and that's part of step away. It's using the science of the power of play, or the theory of play. Yeah. And then we use the theory of flow, because if you're playing, but if we give them some kind of a direction, in this case, we're going to design a game, a serious game. So there's a little bit of direction, but it's so loosely structured because we want folks to get into that flow. where their brain is free and unlocks creativity. And then while they're in that flow, we try to keep them in that flow as long as possible, but not so long that they get burnout or bored or they get mentally exhausted. And then you're free to go swim or go play an arcade game or go play skee ball or go play air hockey or just chill out. There's a giant chessboard in the middle of the room and right in the middle of the house. You can start. There's a giant maze and a giant Scrabble board, and it's just constant play all the time. And you don't have to play all the time. It's like what's really cool design about this house is that some of these larger sort of life-size games are designed where you can play them all week long. You can play one game and it can last all week long. You don't have to just play and finish. And I think that immersive sort of relaxed environment, that atmosphere, and giving people the opportunity to just walk around in their bare feet and shorts and just be that's what I'm saying. It's really hard to explain or just define the experience. It was amazing.
Now, Deb, you've designed games, I think, if I'm not wrong, and you've coded things, and you've also worked in large scale simulations. Mm-hmm. For you, how was this different?
I've done workshops on game design before and help people walk through this process. So what was a little different on this one is that we really, I've done these workshops where I wanted to have people walk away with a working prototype, but we really wanted to get them almost finished with this one. So we did. They play tested it Thursday. So everyone got to try each other's games, and they watched each other, and there was a little bit of, feedback and advice and so forth that came out of that. And it was similar in that, but what was really lovely was that casual atmosphere of we did not have our shoes on during some of the sessions. PowerPoint was like, where's PowerPoint? It's gone. that was so lovely. And then, we took sometimes a swim in the middle of the day. And we had a guy come in who catered, and we just had to stop and, eat. And it was great food. The whole thing was the best experience. It was the best workshop. Unworkshop, whatever. Like Kevin said, we can't quite figure out the total name or how to say it yet. We're getting there, but it was a fantastic experience.
Yeah, it's the one thing we did not solve is our elevator pitch.
Well, yeah, but it makes sense because you're in a collaborative environment. You're not pushing people to do something per se. You have a time constraint of sorts, but the more relaxed someone is, the more they flow, and the more they can come up with ideas and ways to solve problems. You know, what's the old saying? You go to bed at night, you think about a problem, you wake up with a solution. Same kind of idea,
right,
almost.
You're relaxed.
You're relaxed, and when you're relaxed, things flow. Things happen. And if you're relaxed with other people who are relaxed, then it can even generate more results. And that's what I find fascinating about the event, is that collaborative atmosphere, but also that relaxed atmosphere to get people, one, to kind of loosen up a little bit, and two, to just let the thoughts flow. You've got, like you said, a loose parameter of what you need to solve, and there is a time frame of sorts, but you also have the freedom to not force, you can't force a creative to be creative. It doesn't work.
I suppose also what you've got is people are allowed to test it. They're going along. So a lot of the time, if you're doing that, it's trial and error, but trial and error in a very non-threatening environment, because very often people will go, oh, I don't want to show you, what's it going to do? But if you're in a non-environment, then it must make people far more comfortable to test things, to try things.
Right. Like Deborah said, she's, Carl and Deborah were sort of the brain behind the instruction, if we will, in terms of getting folks through the week. Um, I I just sort of put everybody in a big mess and it's like, okay, let's try to figure this out. But the point with that relaxed environment, you know, Devin and Carl have taught these workshops a number of times, and they're still in a nice, relaxed environment. But when you're in fluorescent light in a hotel conference room and you're in business casual, you can only be so relaxed so long because you're not truly disconnected. There's still some kind of connection to your life outside of that room, whether it be work or home or whatever. The atmosphere that with this house, 15,000 square foot house, every room was themed after a game, and just about every room was a game itself. So there were four rooms that were escape rooms. The Scrabble room had puzzles on the wall to solve, Scrabble word kind of games. There was a laser game room. There was just this venue, this atmosphere that it just kind of takes you into that, wow, I can play and I don't have to have permission to play. I can play whenever I want. And the other thing is we left everything out all night long so that anybody wanted to get up early in the morning or after dinner, stay up and keep tinkering with their game. Carl was there, I was there, Deborah was there to ask questions, to consult, to keep coaching. So they were never, if they wanted to take a break, like Deborah was saying, go out, take a swim for a little while, come back in, get some lunch, then get back to work. I think that atmosphere, that environment really, I don't think we could have done it any, we could take this program and put it anywhere else, but I don't think we get the same results if not in that environment.
Yeah,
environment was fantastic. In fact, when I first started Silly Monkey, I had this vision of that of one day my office would kind of look like that. Like I thought I would have my husband make, he was learning woodworking, so I thought I was going to have him make all my conference tables to look like puzzles and it could be put together in different ways. And, you know, I had some really crazy ideas that, you know, would take a lot of money to implement. So it didn't happen. But we are at the Great Escape, and that place is fantastic. We can't wait to get back there. We already had our first meeting on Monday about, you know, booking the next session. And we're going to meet later today and start working through how we're planning the next year. So we can't wait. It was refreshing.
And the conference itself is sort of an experiment as you go.
Mm-hmm. Right.
You're developing and building it, which is, I think, pretty exciting too.
I think we have a really good model, and I think what we didn't expect is the success of what came out the back end, and in that we truly created five serious games, or they did, and we just helped them do it. And I think the feedback we got from them was how exciting it was for them that they didn't realize that they could do that. And it kind of lifted their confidence as well.
Yeah. Let's see.
How many people were involved?
We had nine in the house. Nine total.
Okay.
And that's the other thing, that it's kind of a boutique special event because we have to keep it small. We get too large, too many people. That's too many people to manage and get through all the games and stuff. So one of the challenges we're going to be talking about this afternoon is what does that look like in terms of how many can go at one time? And now that we're out there, we're getting a lot of feedback and we're getting a lot of interest and folks want to know, hey, I want to come next time. So we have to think through how are we going to manage more people want to come than we can accommodate. Which is a good problem to have, but we need to kind of work through that and how we're going to handle that.
Well, you do two or three a year.
Right.
Well, that's one idea. Yeah, I don't mind going back to Orlando a few times a year.
Yeah, that sounds fun. What would you say? What was the most difficult part of it for you individually as developers of the conference? What made you pause a little bit and think, what are we doing?
Probably and Deborah, you might have a different idea. I think we're designers, we're creatives, we mm-hmm. solve problems, but we're not marketers. Mm. We got a late start on marketing the event. And then I think the marketing we did while we were there, the live streaming, the sharing and all that, that really, we should have done that 9 months ago. So lesson learned, but that was probably the most difficult thing. I think we were 2 or 3 months out and we were like, I don't know about this. Do we step off into something that we can't handle? Are we in our over our head? That kind of thing. But it all worked out fine in the end. And then other than that, the week, there was no problems during the week, Deborah. I don't know if I didn't. Guess one thing is, is space. This is a vacation resort. Mm-hmm. For family vacation, so it's not really set up for business conferences. So we had to tweak some things and move some of the stuff around in order to accommodate what we were trying to do. But other than that, I don't see that as a problem.
No, we overcame that pretty easily, I think. We moved tables sometimes outside because it was so nice to have our coffee in the morning outside out by the pool. And then and the sliding glass doors were right there, and all we had to do is just move them right back in place, not very far, so we could do some of our work indoors. But I would say, one of the things that's was a little bit challenging and will always be challenging, I think, with these sorts of things, is to help people kind of get out of their own way. Mm. And I do think that our activities did that and help with that. But people are so, used to being like we were talking about earlier, they're so used to just kind of critiquing themselves and not wanting to share their creative ideas because they're worried that they're going to get some negative feedback because, crying out loud, we get a lot of that.
It's interesting. If you think about it, in the old days, quote unquote, I'll age myself, but that's okay. When you went into a think tank session, when you're having just thinking about things and you're going through ideas, there was always a devil's advocate who would really challenge other people. And it wasn't to make them feel badly, or it was to make them fight a little bit for what their points were, to make them put a little energy into what they wanted to do, not just throw out an idea. And, the concept of all ideas are great. Not really. There's a lot of dumb ideas, but challenge someone a little bit. And I think people aren't used to anything that's a little challenging sometimes with themselves or with others, because they're not used to being on the firing line anymore. And the firing line doesn't make them weak or anything. It doesn't make them bad. It actually strengthens them, but we've kind of gotten away from that. I know Kevin's been in the military. I don't think the military deals very softly with some ideas. You do get challenged. You do. I mean, lives are at stake. So, and to a certain point, if you think about it, money's at stake, people are at stake, jobs are at stake in business. And so there's always that other part that people are afraid to just come out because what if somebody did say something to them? They're not used to it. And that's, I think, an issue with society on the whole right now, where, we've kind of gone a little namby-pamby on ideas and thoughts and everything's great, kumbaya, but that's good. But reality's a little different. And,
right.
But I love the way you guys approach this, especially from let's call it neurological point of view. You're relaxing people, you're letting them flow, you're letting them come out with ideas. How much did you find yourselves mentoring or guiding and letting them do the heavy lifting?
Go ahead, Deborah.
With some, I think there was a little more mentoring and guiding than with others. So, and I guess, you're going to always find that. So, there was some that really couldn't kind of nail down an idea and stick with it. Mm-hmm. So that was fun because we had a goal they have to have a game by the end of the week, and it's going to be published. So, and we did have some other constraints. It's a card game. They worked with some board games as well, and worked on got some parts and pieces to look at board game design. But what we could promise them was a 24 card game in a tuck box, printed and published, so that they can see their working prototype. And you know, if they work on it really hard this week, it'll be finished. I mean, it'll be in good order. Some of them might want to expand it later, but yeah, the constraint of just 24 cards was a little bit difficult to rein people in. So yeah, there was coaching. There was definitely coaching and mentoring along the way.
Yeah, that's part of the critical thinking part of problem solving, because most problems have a lot of constraints or restrictions wrapped around how to solve a problem. So one of our goals was, yeah, we can go in and have a really, really fun game design workshop, but we have to put constraints on it. Otherwise, it's not going to force people into that critical thinking mindset and get them into that flow. So when you're faced with that constraint, you tend to think harder and you think deeper about how to solve that problem. And as Deborah said, we had a couple folks that were had a couple ideas, but didn't know which one they wanted to go with. And then once they got into one, it was a little bit difficult how to get it out. And then we had two folks that were coming completely from outside the learning and development industry, which I think was a pleasant surprise for us, because at first, you know, one of the ideas behind Step Away was a professional development retreat, or like getaway, if you will, for learning and development professionals. But having two folks from outside of our industry coming in and then understanding that the creative process and problem solving is very synonymous across all industries, so it doesn't matter. And they both also were able to go through that program that we had designed and successfully came out the other end equally with a card game. So that's kind of broadened our horizon and our understanding of what we started, and then how do we, I don't know. we've got so many different ideas on how to go forward. And like Deborah said, we're going to be meeting this afternoon to start strategizing for 2020.
I think that's
great. But
if you think about it,
I used to work an awful lot with senior management in various industries. And one of the skills, you know, as your senior leadership team, one of the thing that the senior leadership team, the senior management team has to do is to problem solve, but also to be able to get other people be engaged in the problem that needs to be solved. So I would imagine, I can see that the interest outside learning and development, because in senior management, that's essentially an awful lot of what they do too.
Yeah, one of the ideas that we're kicking around is a boutique leadership development focused on C-level executives or leadership, where just that level of executives come in and do the same program, but it's a shared audience, professional development in L&D industry, maybe bringing in complete teams from a single organization to work through how do they work together as a team. There's countless ways that we can expand and do this. So we have to settle our excitement down and narrow our focus
one step at a time. Yeah.
Well, you guys are great. I mean, all three of you are great. The work you guys do and the ideas, I think, for the industry are great. And you know, they're just good ideas, good things for people to go through and to develop with. So we wish you just the best of luck and success on the next ones. Well, let's say ones.
Yes.
Because I think, like you guys said, this is the first one. You're developing it. It's growing, and you guys are dangerous. You're actually very dangerous. We'll have to see. Now, you guys are really great, and we're
keep
so
us
glad
updated.
You
keep us in the loop. Keep
yeah. Well, I had an idea as you were talking, and we'd more than love to help out with this. If you guys want to do any kind of streaming live and we could just restream things you're doing or whatever else, or even do on-the-spot interviews. We'll make it a reality show if you want, but we could have some fun with that and something just to think about.
No, it's exactly what we did. We did a couple live streams last week. Cool. Some went really well.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was one of the things that we definitely want to do is bring it, because again, it's a boutique, so it's going to be a small audience, but
yeah,
that doesn't mean we can't share the experience while we're doing it. So one of the things was, we didn't have the equipment or we didn't have a plan set up, but we just kind of turned on Facebook Live and different yep. things throughout the week.
Yeah.
But yeah, that's definitely something that's part of the plan for next year, to actually be actually strategize and plan that next year. But thank you for the offer. We'll definitely be in touch with that.
Yeah, so it could be fun. And I'm just glad you guys did it. You guys are gutsy, and you're contributing a lot to an industry that really needs some fresh thoughts. So this is good.
Thank you.
Kevin, Deb, appreciate you guys coming on today. We jokingly call you guys the three amigos here, because it's great to see what friendship and expertise and collaboration can bring up. And I've known all of you for at least some time. Deb, I met almost a decade ago in a different project.
Right, right.
And that's when I heard your name, I went, I know Deb. That was cool. and
like
it's funny how quick
I pop up.
Yeah, and it's funny how we lose track of ourselves and people. Everybody's too busy. And that's exactly what's wonderful about the event you've done with Step Away. Because
don't stay away.
Yeah, walk away at the end. Step away in the beginning. Because, you know, you're giving people something, one, they're not going to forget, and two, it sounds like they'll get a lot out of. And I think that part's absolutely wonderful. So congratulations on having your first show, having a good time with it, and we wish you just a lot more success and opportunities for everyone on the next ones. I know there's going to be next ones, so that'll be great. And if
we'll announce 2020 dates probably in another week or so.
That sounds great. That's so good. That way people can get budgets going. Actually, that's good, because people are doing budgets right now towards the end of the year, so not a bad time to do it.
Yeah.
I know some people that want to go but didn't have it in their budgets. So that this could be good timing.
That's again, that goes back on us not knowing how to market properly, you know. So
yeah, but no one knows. But you know what? Don't feel badly. No one knows how to market. It's all trial and error, and then eventually somebody gets it. That's just the way it is. You know, unless you have hundreds of millions in marketing dollars, it's not that easy to market. Though there's a lot of things that can be done, and like you guys said, by doing it early, that goes in budgets. People say, you know what, I really want to do this because blah, blah, blah. And like you said, get that message out there of how you want it to work, because I think the collaborative part and the idea that they're learning something that can benefit a company, an agency, whatever, afterwards is the key. And it sounds like you did that. So that's great. Well, Kevin, Deb, we really appreciate you coming on again.
Thank you.
Wish you best as always, and we look forward to seeing you. Are you both going to DevLearn?
Yes, I'll be there.
Well, I'll get together with you guys when you're out there. We're going to be there too. My wife and I are going. We're looking forward to seeing people, especially people like you. So it'll be fun. Leslie, are you going?
No, I was the guild were talking about it, but it's not going to work this year.
Not this year. Hopefully next year. And for all you people watching, we have information below on the Step Away Conference, the one that happened already, but there'll be another one coming soon. And please contact the folks. And we'll also have Leslie's LinkedIn information. So if you want to say hi to her and wish her great luck on being a granny and her son's wedding, please do so. Have a good one, everyone. Thanks for watching. And we'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.